Hi, I'm Stephen James, and I'm really excited to be with you today. I'm going to take you in a completely new direction with your torch enameling techniques. Today, we're going to work with metal design stamps, leatherwork stamps, and transparent enamels. We're going to pull all of them together, and we're going to make some amazing designs that are unique to just you. We're going to get started right now, but before we start torch enameling, we need to take a look at some of our safety tips. Whenever you torch enamel, you need to be not only creative, but safe as well. And these are some of the tools that I like to use in my own studio. First and foremost, I like to have a fire extinguisher. Even though we're working on a very small scale, a small problem can become a big situation in no time. So always have a fire extinguisher on hand. I also like to work with safety goggles or glasses. I think I look pretty good, don't you? And of course, we don't want to forget our friend, the dust mask. And we wear our dust mask when we sift because we don't want to inhale or ingest the glass enamel that we're working with. And I also want to come back to the goggles. You should wear these whenever you're firing, but you can keep them on throughout the entire process. Now, one of the other things I want to encourage you to do is to continually wash your hands throughout the process, especially with some of the new techniques that I'm showing you. You can get a little messy, and we don't want that glass on your hand, and we ultimately don't want it to get into your eyes or anywhere else. So please wash your hands throughout today's class. And then after you're done, maybe you take a nice long hot shower and enjoy all of the hard work. The shower is going to help get rid of any of the glass that might have found its way where it's not supposed to be. This is a great technique, but there are very special things to remember when you're working with it. We're going to be working with both hands today, our dominant hand and our non-dominant hand. You can see in my right hand, which is my dominant hand, I'm holding our tool that will make the impression. It's a regular screw from the hardware store. And I have also my torch in my non-dominant hand. You can see how I'm holding the torch, and the flame is heading directly into the trivet area. It is not pointing back towards me because I'm using my dominant hand to actually make the impression. So let's see what it looks like. If my torch were on, the flame would be traveling across the brick and not back towards me. This is one thing I want you to remember when you start the class and start this technique. Today, these are some of the tools that you'll be working with. The first tool is, I think, one of the most important tools, is actually a non-combustible metal surface, and I'm using a metal sheet placed on my table. I also will add two kiln bricks to that surface, and I use two kiln bricks to add height to my work area. You'll notice that I have a stainless steel trivet, a pair of stainless steel pliers, a pair of bent nose pliers, and you can tell that they're not my best pair. I encourage you to reserve your best pair of pliers for wire work. I'm also using a max flame butane torch, and don't forget to include the gas. Use a high quality butane fuel. I have a pair of safety goggles, and off camera you don't see that I have a water bowl. In case I happen to have any accidents, I can quickly quench my hand and fingers. I also have a fire extinguisher in the studio. We'll need a hole punch to make a hole in the metal, and you can use whichever hole punch you prefer. We'll need a copper cleaner. In this case, I'm using Penny Bright, as well as an old toothbrush. You need a little bit of water as well. I have a towel to dry off my work, sifting cups, and a variety of brushes. A variety of enamel colors in opaque and transparent, as well as a dust mask. Magazine sheets for sifting, black undercoat enamel, leatherwork metal stamps, and steel metal pieces. I found these at my local hardware store. If you choose to make one of the designs with letter or design stamps encased under glass, you'll need design stamps, bench block, a letter set, brass mallet, and a plastic mallet. Before we begin our project, we have to actually punch a hole. I'm going to use my handheld punching plier. And now my metal is ready to be cleaned. I'm actually going to be using our copper cleaner, Penny Bright, as well as a little water and a toothbrush. I like to clean the back side of the piece, and you can tell it's the back side by feeling for the tiny burr that was produced with my hole puncher. Your metal should be clean and free of oil, grease, grime, whatever might prevent the enamel from fusing to the copper surface. The surface of the copper should be dry before you add the enamel. Our piece is ready for the counter enamel, and we'll be adding a black counter enamel next. Now that we have cleaned our metal and we have a hole in our metal, we need to add a counter enamel to the back side of the piece. A counter enamel is going to help stabilize the front side of our design. It's important to have a counter enamel as well as a front side to your finished piece. It prevents chipping or breakage of the glass design on the front. I often use black enamel as my counter enamel because it's the one color that doesn't interact with the torch flame. So I'm using a small cap to hold my metal off the surface of my sifting sheet, which is this magazine sheet. This little tip right here is wonderful if you happen to have shaky hands or you have trouble using tweezers to pick up the metal. So I'm going to position it for sifting. I have my mini sifter right here, and it's already full of my black enamel. And then I'm going to follow the shape of my design, which is a circle, so I'm sifting in a circular motion. As you can see, I'm scratching the handle of the tool in order to allow for an even application. It's important to have both the counter enamel as well as the front side. It's important for them to be equal in terms of amount of enamel. Now that I've sifted my enamel onto the surface of the metal, I'm ready to transfer it to the trivet and fire my piece. Now that we've sifted our counter enamel onto the back side of our piece, we need to transfer our copper piece to our stainless steel trivet. You can see that I've placed it on a kiln brick, and I'm going to bring in my copper disc. Now, if you are not using tools such as a pair of tweezers or a bent nose plier to transfer your metal, please be careful if you are using a hot trivet. You don't want to accidentally burn yourself. So I like to practice this transferring with my hands using bare copper that has no counter enamel on it. We're going to remove all of the combustible materials from our firing zone, which is around the kiln brick, and now we're going to actually fire. We're going to use a max flame torch today, and if you haven't had a chance to check out the torch safety video at beaducation.com, I encourage you to learn more about working with a torch. Before you fire, you should actually put on your safety goggles. We should always wear safety goggles when we fire. I'm going to introduce the flame into the project area, and I'm turning it up on the side. And the point of my flame is directly under the metal. You can see it going through all three stages: sugar coat, orange peel, and then it's finally fused. And I'm going to stop right there. Because there's only one layer of enamel on here, the counter enamel, the process is happening very quickly. So I'm going to allow it to cool for about a minute, and then I'm going to use my bent nose pliers to remove the metal. Now that my project has cooled to the touch, I'm able to remove it from the kiln brick. I can see my counter enamel has set, and on the backside, a lot of fire scales showed up. So we need to actually remove it, and we're going to remove it again with the Penny Bright copper cleaner that we used before. I'm also using an old toothbrush and a little bit of water to do so. It does take a little bit of elbow grease, but you can actually remove all of this fire scale with this Penny Bright. I actually like to start in the palm of my hand, and I feel like I have a better grip on the project by cupping my hand. As I said, it takes a little bit of elbow grease. Let's check our progress. You can see that the Penny Bright is really doing a number on the fire scale in the middle of my project. So you want to make sure that you're moving your brush around. There's a variety of ways to actually clean your project, but I love the Penny Bright because it's a citric acid-based cleaner. So it's biodegradable, and it's a natural way to clean your enameling pieces. Let's check our progress again. You can see that it's doing quite a great job. Now I'm going to concentrate on this area as well as this area. I'm going to shift that around. Okay, we're almost done cleaning our project. And it'll take a quick bath in my water bin to remove all of the Penny Bright, because we're getting ready to sift on the front of the design. Now, remember, we don't want any Penny Bright inside of that hole, so you might want to use your tweezers or a toothpick to remove water as well as leftover Penny Bright. We'll thoroughly dry it. And I don't see any Penny Bright inside the hole. It's now ready for the front part of my design. We're now ready to actually add the enamel to the front side of our design. You can see that the copper is clean and dry, and I'm also placing it back on that cap to hold it off the surface. If you feel comfortable using a pair of tweezers on a flat surface, by all means, I encourage you to do that. But I actually like this new method of applying enamel. I need to add 2 coats of enamel to the front side of this piece, and I'm going to do it one right after the other. First, I'm going to use a large sifter, and I'm going to add an opaque white to the front of my design. Again, I'm going to follow the formation, or follow the shape rather, of my project. So I'm sifting in a circular formation. You can see that the enamel has fallen off the sides down here. I need to get a new sheet for a new color of enamel. So I will be swapping this one out. Carefully remove. You don't want to contaminate your colors. Now I'm going to add a transparent color to the center of this disc. And I'm not going in a circular formation at this point. Now I'm just concentrating on the center of my piece. This piece is now ready to be fired. I'll be placing it on my trivet to fire, and I'll also be using these metal stamps to monogram the hot enamel. I have my metal placed in position on top of my stainless steel trivet. You might notice that it's a little different in terms of placement. I actually am going to fire from this side of the enamel because this is my non-dominant hand, and I'm going to stamp from this side of the enamel because this is my dominant hand. I'm right-handed. I'd like to show you what we're going to do without any of the flame so that you have a full understanding of what you need to do. I have my metal stamp right now, and it's in my dominant hand. You should actually hot press with the metal stamp using your dominant hand. You'll have much more control over the process that way. I'm also at the same time going to be firing with my non-dominant hand. So my torch flame will be coming from this side, and I will come in once the enamel has reached the molten stage and come in to press. Now, you want to make sure that your area is clear of any combustible material. You should put on your safety goggles as well, and you want to make sure that your trivet is stabilized on your kiln brick. I'm going to turn my torch on. Introduce the flame into it. And I have it at maximum length because I want to have a really nice hot piece of glass. I'm gonna follow the shape. I have my stamp on this side. You can see it's going through the stages right now. Once it reaches that temperature, I'm going to come in. Hot press and release. I've turned off my torch. I've also set my metal stamp down onto a fire-resistant surface. I do not quench these tools. I allow them to cool naturally. The project piece also needs to cool down too. As it cools down, you'll often see that the transparent colors will come back to their true nature. This is actually a water blue that I'm using. You might have noticed that it went to green, but as it cools down, it becomes more of its true color. Now, one of the things I'm noticing about today's project piece is that it's a little thin in some of the areas. The beauty about enamel is that I can actually repeat the process if I don't like what turns out. I'm taking it off the trivet. I also noticed that my stamp isn't as deep as I'd like it to be. So I have the opportunity to redo this piece by adding more of the white as well as more of the transparent. We're going to come back in and see if we can fix that B. If you recall from our previous firing, I didn't really like the results. So I decided to redo it, and it's so easy to do. Now, I have waited for the project to cool back down. I've removed any kind of flaky fire scale that might be on the perimeter. I didn't have to clean it all again with Penny Bright. I just wanted to remove any flakes of fire scale because I don't want them inside of my enamel. I also sifted more white and more transparent enamel onto my project piece. I'm hoping that I have enough now to really get the results that I wanted to. So we're going to follow the same steps that we did before. We'll hold the torch in our non-dominant hand, and we'll hold the stamping tool in our dominant hand. Turning on my torch one more time. Grabbing my tool. Now, I'm gonna come back in again, firing from underneath. It might take a little longer because you have more enamel on your project today, but I see that it's going through the stages. We want to make sure that this enamel is nice and molten. The temperature should be anywhere from 14 to 1500 degrees. I think it's ready for my impression. Come in and remove. Now again, all of the material, rather all of the tools that you're working with today will get just as hot as the enamel. So we're going to allow everything to cool, including the tool that we just used. As a reminder, you do not quench these tools. You allow them to cool naturally. I also want to be, I want you to be mindful, rather, that this is a steel tool and that it does acquire heat throughout the tool. So as you use them, you should be mindful that you will have heat all the way up here. Now, as this project starts to cool, I can see that my B is actually showing up much better than before. And I'll move my trivet out of the way. And you can see that I'm using tools to actually handle my project piece today. There are a variety of transparent colors that are out there, and I encourage you to explore them and work with them. You can see that I love the water blue and how it looks with my B. Now I'm going to show you actually how to texture the hot glass with tools and materials that you would find in the hardware store. You can see I'm actually showing you a screw from the hardware store. We're going to run this across the hot glass while we're firing it, and that should leave a very interesting impression in the glass. Now, it's very important that you practice these steps before you fire. I'm holding the screw in my dominant hand. That way I have more control over the rolling process. I'll be holding the torch in my non-dominant hand. It's important for the torch to be underneath the metal, firing the enamel, and it's important for me to have control over the impression tool. You can see I've set my trivet up. I have my piece firmly in place, and I'm making sure that my trivet is stabilized. I actually like to stand when I'm doing this technique, but you should do something that is most comfortable for you, but you should position everything in a place should you accidentally tip over the trivet or have any other issues, that your materials, your tools, will fall onto your heat-resistant surface. Now, I'm getting ready to turn on my torch. I'm putting my safety goggles on, and I'm going to bring my glass up to the stage that will allow me to fire, or rather, make my impression. I also like to hold the torch tip in a direction where the heat is not coming into contact with my hand, holding my very long screw. I'm going to make my impression now. Slowly roll it over. And then turn off your torch. Set your screw down to cool naturally. I don't like to quench these tools. This is so exciting because now we are working with stamped metal as well as enamel. So I'm going to encase stamped designs under glass. Now, if you've never stamped metal, a wonderful video to watch is stamping on metal. And Lisa's video is great. It's going to teach you all the ins and outs on how to stamp on metal. You can see I watched your video and then I stamped this metal disc first. Then I counter enamel the piece. Now you might be asking yourself, well, why can't I counter enamel and then stamp? Well, the force of the stamping is clearly going to crack the glass on the back. So the very first step is to stamp your design. Now that we have a design, we have our counter enamel, we've cleaned the fire scale that will form during the counter enameling process, we're ready to add a transparent coat of enamel. I'm going to use my sifting sheet again. And if you're not using that trick that I've shown you before where you place this on a cap, make sure that your hole is at 12 o'clock. That way you'll always be able to find it. I have my sifter cup full of transparent enamel. And you can see it's white, but once I fire it, it will be clear. Transparent enamels come in a variety of colors. Today we are simply using a clear glass. I'm going to follow my design and its shape, which is circular. You want to make sure you have a nice even coat on your piece. With transparents, you want to make sure that the enamel is not too thick because you don't want to lose the design that is underneath the glass. This piece is ready to be fired, so I need to transfer it to my trivet, and I'll use a pair of tweezers to do so. Now, in a few seconds, we're going to see our stamped design appear underneath our clear, transparent glass, and I can't wait for it to show back up. I'm turning my torch on, and I'm going to start firing my piece. Transparent enamels go through the same stages as opaque. I'm going to fire it a little bit longer. And it is done. Now, my copper color is really showing through the clear enamel. I want to let it cool down a little bit before I take it off the trivet. And as the project, both the glass and the metal, start to cool down, I'll see more of the color that I want to see. I'll use my bent nose pliers now to remove the piece. I'm going to scoot this guy back and let him cool right there. You can already see, hopefully, that the copper color is starting to come back. This is an example of a stamp design under glass. I'm thrilled with the way this piece turned out, actually. I love that you can see the stamp designs underneath the glass, and the color of the copper is really coming through. It's really successful. Now, it is a clear, transparent glass, which some people might find to be a little boring, and they might actually want to add a little bit of color. As I mentioned earlier, transparents do come in color, and you are encouraged to actually explore with transparent enamels. Now, my one tip would be that a thinner layer is going to be best. You don't want to lose the design underneath the glass. And if you add too much of a transparent, the intensity of the color is going to overshadow your stamped design. Now, I'm one to explore different techniques and different ideas, so I encourage you to pick up a few extra blanks and continue to push this technique even further with different designs as well as different colors. In this example, I fired clear glass directly over my stamped design. I did not use an undercoat and embed it inside the stamp design, but now I'd like to show you the difference between those two techniques. In the last example, I showed you how to fire stamped impressions under transparent enamel. And now I'm going to do it again, but this time I'm going to use an undercoat enamel inside the impressions. An undercoat enamel is a finely ground enamel. It almost looks like baby powder. And I'll put a little bit on our magazine sheet because we are going to need that in just a little bit. Now, the undercoat enamel is embedded into the recessed areas of my stamp design. I'll be adding the undercoat into the areas on my design by wetting the undercoat enamel. After it's dried, I'm going to add a transparent enamel. This color, black, is going to really make my stamp design pop through my transparent enamel. As I said, I want to add the undercoat wet, so I'm going to dip my finger in a little bit of water, and you can see that I'm starting to wet the enamel. I'm going to run the undercoat enamel through the design. I usually will run it in one direction in order to fill it up. There isn't an exact science to this, and because you have not fired your piece, you can keep doing it until you feel like you have an even coverage in your piece. Now, one of the things to remember is that any undercoat that is on the surface of your metal will fire along with the transparent. You can see there are some areas that I would like to remove. There's no need to have it right there, and there's no need to have it right under there. So I'm going to come in with a small brush to remove it. Because you've stamped your design into your metal, you're not going to shake loose anything that has been embedded into the design. my piece is now ready to be fired. You can see the undercoat has been embedded into our stamp design. Let's put our undercoat away. Let's get a new sheet of paper. And let's get ready to sift our transparent enamel. I'm using a clear transparent enamel. As I mentioned earlier, you can explore colored transparent enamels. However, you want to make sure that your enamel is not too thick or you will not be able to see your stamped design. I'm going to follow the formation of my design by going in a circular motion. And now I'm ready to fire. I'm going to transfer this once again with my tweezers. And I'm transferring it to my trivet. We're now ready to fire the piece, and I'm going to position my trivet, making sure that it's in the correct firing position. And I'll be firing right underneath the piece with my torch. Now you can see that my design has disappeared, but in about a minute, it should show back up. This is a transparent enamel with an undercoat embedded into the stamp design. It's going to go through all of the stages that we often look for: sugar coat, orange peel, and then fully fused. The design's coming through. Isn't it lovely? And I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to let my piece cool down a little bit before I come in and take it off the trivet with a pair of pliers. Now, it's a very dark piece right now, but as the metal cools down and as the enamel cools down, that color will brighten a little bit more. Although, you can't really go wrong with annealed copper. It has so many lovely tones in it. Let's take it off and see what we've got. You can actually really see that undercoat has been fired into the stamp design. I can see the black is part of my copper, and as it cools down even more, we're gonna get those lovely copper colors. I'm thrilled with the way this piece turned out. As I mentioned, you can really see the undercoat embedded into the letters as well as the stamp design. Now, you can spend a lot of time working with that undercoat to get it just right. And I encourage you to spend as much time as you need to make sure that the undercoat is where it needs to be. I want to draw your attention down here. I might have spent just a few more moments getting rid of the undercoat right there, but I think this is a really successful design. And I think when you're at home, you're actually able to focus on the technique and create some lovely pieces. Hey, I hope you had a wonderful time learning this technique. I know I had a great time teaching it to you. Now, if you have any questions or you want to give us feedback or you want to see more of my videos, I encourage you to check me out as well as my classes at beaducation.com.